No, but
I'm sorry.
Speakers.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming. My name is Jennifer Bai, and I am part of the group that coordinated the efforts for this evening. I am a Stillwater area parent. I live in Oak Park Heights, and thank you all for coming.
And I'm Christy Mack, and I have two kids in the district, and I'm just a concerned parent and citizen and want to help keep people informed on different matters in the area.
I'm Megan Greeter, also a parent and concerned resident.
I'm Andy McCready, and I'm a resident of Stillwater, and I'm going to introduce the Stillwater area informed residents, including these people back here. It's a group of residents and concerned parents who are interested in various topics relating to our schools, and so we've invited some expert speakers to educate us on certain topics. The first, we will have four topics today, and the topics will be clean water in schools, bullying prevention, student and teacher safety, and emergency response. Each speaker will have up to 20 minutes to speak, and then we'll have a Q&A for 10 minutes afterwards, and I will be holding up this card to indicate for the speaker to stop at a certain time. And the final speaker will be the Oak Park Police Department, and that will be a Q&A the entire time, so the whole 30 minutes. To ask a question from the audience, come up to the lectern and speak into the microphone. And then please try to keep your question having a local angle rather than a national angle, because we're interested in issues that affect our specific community. So the first speaker is the Minnesota Department of Health. Clean water in schools is the topic, and Daniel Simonek, PhD, is currently the assistant manager for the drinking water protection section at the Minnesota Department of Health. He was the director of the Healthy Housing and Childhood Lead Poisoning Prevention Program at MDH from 2000 to 2015. Dr. Simonek has been with MDH for 25 years in a variety of roles in the Environmental Health Division. And then he will be giving the presentation, and then Anna Schleep is here for questions. She is a compliance engineer for the Drinking Water Protection Section at the Minnesota Department of Health. And prior to working at MDH, she taught physics, chemistry, and mathematics in Minnesota, New York, and Maine. Ms. Schleep earned her bachelor's degree from the University of Minnesota Morris and holds a master's degree in both physics and in engineering from the University of Maine. So, you can begin.
Very good. Well, we appreciate the opportunity to come here tonight and talk about lead as an issue, and in particular the way it's impacting our schools and the water. Obviously, with Ferguson, Flint in Michigan, you know, it's a topic that's gotten a lot of attention lately, and one that actually there was a 2017 legislation that we'll talk a little bit about that specifically addressed the way we're addressing lead in schools. So it certainly is a very pertinent issue. Just generally kind of what we'll cover tonight is just some background on lead health effects and trends, because in the last 5 or 6 years we really have fundamentally changed the way we look at lead as a toxicant. For years it was one way, and there really has been a change. So we'll kind of update some of that, talk about some of the lead sources, because while lead in schools certainly is a concern, it is in lots of different areas of our environment still. You would think after 2,000 years of knowing lead is toxic that we would have figured out we shouldn't put it in stuff anymore, but it just keeps showing up in things to our ongoing frustration. Then some of the specific leads in water, some of the guidelines, because unfortunately there's lots of different guidelines that don't always play nice together with lead in water. And then finally some of the things you can do at home to help reduce your lead exposure. So just in general, the health effects of lead. A lot of those up at the top of that chart up there with the death and the encephalopathy and those kinds of, we've known those for a long time, that as those high levels of lead, you know, certainly cause dramatic acute health effects drooped hands. Actually, unfortunately, Minnesota has the notoriety of, we have the last lead fatality occurred in Minnesota. That was in 2005 when a child swallowed a Reebok charm from a pair of shoes and it winds up, it was pure lead. Talk about an interesting day at the office. That was quite an adventure. And we do still occasionally get reports in from that microgram per deciliter is the amount in your blood. We will still get some in the 30 and the 40 and occasionally a 60 or a 70, but we really don't get those anymore. We've come a long way in preventing lead. Now, where we're really trying to make inroads now and get folks to pay attention to are those way down at the bottom of that, down at 10 and 5 micrograms per deciliter. So when a child has a blood lead level down there, there really is no impact. They don't feel sick. They don't look sick. There's nothing that's going on. What it is it's interfering with the development of their brain. And so it's not something like a doctor can go look and see. So that's why our public health approach of primary prevention is very important, of knowing the risk factors, and then based on that, you do your interventions. So here again, that we've made progress, you know, you can look back to 2000, we had on the left-hand side are the number of children above 5, so that is our definition of elevated. And on the right-hand side, which is the line, those are the number of kids above 15, which is where enforcement actually comes in. So someone from the health department will knock on your door and look, and they have the ability to write orders and those kinds of things. And so, you know, back in the 2000s, we had, you know, 400 kids that were that needed attention from a legal enforcement standpoint, and we've gotten that down to well under 100 now. So we really have done a good job in getting lead out of the environment. We're just not quite done yet. You know, that doesn't quite get down to zero. And so our challenge really is, you know, back in the 70s when lead was in gasoline, I mean, our risk was way up here, and we got rid of the lead in the gasoline. Well, then we started working on lead in houses because it was lead in paint, and that whole time the lead in water has been down here. It hasn't really changed over the years, but now as we make progress with lead in homes, now all of a sudden this begins to become significant. And so that's kind of, it's not that we've suddenly discovered lead in water. I mean, it's been there all the time, but when you have a risk way up here, you're not going to work on this one. You're going to work on the most important one. And so in some ways, it's a reflection of our progress that we actually can worry about lead in water. That means we've gotten it out of all the other places. So the other thing about lead is people get very frustrated because it's like, well, just make up your mind. Like, where is it going to be toxic? And one of the things that our department really functions on is we learn stuff. We track the research. And you can see over the years, starting back in 1960, the level that was considered harmful was 60 micrograms per deciliter. Back in the 60s. If we would get a 60 today, that's considered a medical emergency and we would call an ambulance and they would go in for chelation to the nearest hospital. So that shows you how much we have changed the way we view lead as it has gradually come down as we do better. And then you can see there in 2012, it actually comes down to they're really, based on the epidemiology, there is no safe level of lead. It kind of acts like a carcinogen where there really is no, there always was this number, like we'll just get to that and then you're fine. But we kind of don't have that number anymore. And that's this fundamental change. For years and years and years, we were always like shooting for something. And even though we moved the number, there always was something we were shooting for. And now we've completely transitioned into a primary prevention model. Now the challenge with that is, because lead is in so many different places, it's not reasonable to say, well, if there's no safe level, there should be no lead. I get it, where that comes from, and you know, there's real appeal to saying that, but it's just not practical because it's in so many things. So we have to, unless we had like infinite resources, which I'll go, you know, talk to Governor Dayton about that. I'm sure he'll be happy to give us infinite, you know, there's only, and schools are the same thing. They don't have infinite amounts of money. So you have to make sure the money that you have, you apply to the highest risk to get the most benefit out of it, recognizing that you can't do everything, even though you want to. So it's kind of hard. So even though you'll hear us say there's no safe level of blood lead exposure, which is true according to the research, we have to find a way to balance that to what is a reasonable approach. And so you get into risk assessment and local priorities and all those kinds of things, which is where we then try and set it up so that the local communities can really make their own risk priority decisions. So all those different things that lead is in. By far still, it's in lead in paint in houses. So it's houses built before 1978. The paint that was used on windows and doors, what happens is as the window goes up and down, it creates a dust. The dust gets down on the floor. The most risk person is a child between 9 months or so when they start crawling up to about 2 years, and it's hand to mouth. And so when the dust gets on the floor, the child goes by, gets on the hands, hand goes in the mouth, which is a normal developmental stage. That's perfectly normal for kids to put their hands in their mouth. But when it's covered in lead dust, that's how it gets into the child. And so that remains the most common exposure that we have today. But as you can see, it's not the only one. We still get some coming in from outside the U.S., you know, this Reebok charm and some other events. The pots there are bean pots in Hispanic communities. They bake great beans, and they do. They make great beans, except that glaze has lead in it, which is just not good. And like a note on the paint, the reason they put the lead in the paint in the first place is because it makes really good paint. I mean, it sticks, and it's bright, and it cleans, and it's great paint. It just has this neurotoxin in it. So, and then, you know, all these other objects. So, unfortunately, it still is in lots of places, and that really is our challenge. So now for lead in water, it really isn't typically found in that source water, so it's almost never, in fact, to my knowledge, never has been found in the actual groundwater or the surface water that kind of comes into the plant. And then they process it, and it gets sent out in the distribution system. Where it really comes from is those plumbing, what they call premise plumbing, which is the plumbing that's kind of inside the house. When the water sits, then that allows the lead to get into the water. And then when you turn on the tap, then the lead comes out. Now, if the lead runs and the water keeps going, then the lead doesn't have a chance because lead isn't real soluble. I mean, it's a metal. It's not, you know, like some other chemicals where it just is soluble right away. The water has to kind of stand still. So that corrosion that you can see, this is where Flint got in trouble, because when they changed their water, the chemistry changed, and when the chemistry changed, it began corroding away. You can see actually that gunk on the inside of the pipe. As I'm learning about water systems, when I first looked at that, I'm like, ew, get rid of that. And in fact, no, that's the safety layer that goes in from the orthophosphates. I know it looks kind of creepy, but really that helps protect the exposure to that pipe right there. And when you erode that away, then you get into the potential lead that's in that pipe. So we really get down to that factor of it depends on how long the water sits there. So it's not like other water contaminants where we can sample for it, and if it's there, it's there. You know, I probably shouldn't say PFCs out here, but, you know, that's either there or it isn't. And if we sample and we find it, we know it's going to be there. Lead, you could go there one day and it would be real high, and you would sample the next day, and because you ran all the water, you would get non-detect at the very same place. And so it's a real challenge to kind of nail that down. So some of these sources of lead in home plumbing, you know, some of the copper pipe has lead solder. So, you know, where you connect the piping and you put the solder in there. Now, the newer stuff has lead out of it, but there still is, you know, that was one of the sources. These faucets, again, you know, why it still gets used, and we spend lots of time working with manufacturers and checking, but it still, you know, still comes in. You can see the pipes and the lead goosenecks and those kinds of things in the water system. This lead service line that you may have heard a lot about, that actually is the line that takes it from the main out in the street and takes it into your house. So that's called the service line. And in a lot of older homes, that can actually be made out of lead. It's easy to mold. It was cheap to come by. You know, it was an inexpensive solution. Again, it's just made out of a neurotoxin, so that just is not. And the problem with that is infrequently what will happen is the city will own to the sidewalk and the homeowner will own the rest of it. So when we say, well, let's replace it, well, what's it? Are you going to replace the city part? Are you going to do the homeowner? Well, now you're on private property. Well, who's going to pay for that? Because that's private property. And if you only do half of it, remember that corrosion stuff, if you bang on that pipe, you knock all that loose, and then here comes your lead. So it's very intuitive to say, well, let's just take out all the lead service lines. Unfortunately, like most things in the environmental sciences, it's not quite that simple. So as far as lead in schools, one of our challenges is we're the Minnesota Department of Health, so we're the statewide health agency. And when we start to talk about schools, you can see there's all the districts. So I defy you to come up with one statement on anything that applies to every one of those little colored circles. I mean, it's not that we don't want to come up with guidance that fits. There just isn't. The schools are new and they're old, and they're big and they're small, and they're used 2 days a week and 7 days a week, and they were built in 2014 and built in 1930, and some were kept up really good and some, you know, had maintenance challenges. There's just too many variables to come out and for the health department to say, do this and it will work. So the way we structure our guidance really kind of presents a range of opportunities that the local school district can then pick and implement that'll be most effective for their building. Because really, as we work with schools, they are just as concerned about, you know, that those are their students too. They want to protect those students. They want to do the right thing and make sure that they can do it. It's just that, you know, they have a lot of other challenges too. So lots of different schools. Now here's the regulations, and I'm not going to go through them in detail, but just to see, you know, some go back into the 90s, some even go back into the 80s. And let me tell you, in 1988, the mean population blood lead level, 88% of the people in the country had a blood lead above 10 micrograms per deciliter, which is defined as elevated today. Let me repeat that. 88% of the population in the country had a blood lead above 10 in the early 80s. That's me, by the way. So it's every time I don't get something, I'm like, yeah, see, it's, remember when I grew up. So number one, we've come a long way from that. But number two, as you know, when these laws were put in, it was just a very different understanding and a very different environment of the way we did things. So some of these are guidance, you know, so we want them to do things. Some of these are statutes where we actually have enforcement authority. Some of the Safe Drinking Water Acts, they're designed to protect the whole system. And so they have a way of collecting in certain places, and then if the 90th percentile is below a certain number, then they meet the standard. Well, you could have one house that's really high, and that percentage would still be low. And so it's a challenge to then use that law to come into a single school and say, well, based on this law, you have to do something, because that's just not the way it's put together. So here's the law that got passed. 2017, it's going to become effective in July 1st. It required three things. The school has to have a plan for sampling. They have to test the water at least every 5 years. And then they have to make those results publicly available. So that's what the law said. And we have to base that on some of the current guidance, not all of which is the most current. So we're trying to find a way to make sure that we have the most current public health prevention or information in there along with some of the old ones. So those are the three aspects that the law has to do. But because we're the public health agency, just testing and giving you the numbers, that's not public health. So we want, once those numbers come out, now what? What should we do? And so these are some of the things that you can do at home to reduce your levels of water, your exposure from water, but a lot of these also apply to the schools. And so, you know, tonight we're talking about the schools, but really these do apply to both as far as using the cold water and let the water run. You know, again, if the water is moving, it doesn't collect the lead. And keep those aerators clean. So if like a little piece comes off, goes out and it gets stuck in the aerator, if you just take that off, you can clean that out. That'll frequently help. So what happens if you find lead? And, you know, you would have to take that sample and send it into a certified lab, and they will do that for you. They'll come back and give you the concentration. That doesn't mean you automatically have to go ahead and replace all of your plumbing. Just like when a school finds a high level, that doesn't automatically mean that they have to go in and rip out all the plumbing and put everything new in. There are a variety of ways, some that may be legitimate in a certain situation, some that frankly may not. Again, you have to understand the building to know what's going to work best. But this let the water run, sometimes you do need to replace it. Some of the filters or these other big treatments. So there are a range of things. We do have things that will help take out lead or reduce your exposure to lead. The challenge is coming up with that best approach for your specific situation. So these are just some simple things you can do. We're the public health agency. Wash your hands. Imagine that. It's, all these big medical studies we do, and we can just get people to wash their hands. We would, make huge progress on this. And if you are in one of those high-risk things as far as washing the toys, and, if you happen to be working at a job that has it, and careful with the clothes. And you can see our website on the bottom there. If you just Google Minnesota Department of Health Lead, you'll get to our website, and there's lots of background and fact sheets and recommendations and how-tos on there. So these are just kind of more of the same, as you can imagine with the carpets, if you have a hardwood floor and that dust falls down there, you can kind of clean that up a little more effectively, but that gets down in the carpet, that becomes very difficult. And then if you take a vacuum cleaner and you're like, well, I'll clean it up with a vacuum cleaner, well, now basically my friends in Healthy Homes say the vacuum cleaners are just perfect aerosolization. So now you've just taken it and put it as a fine dust on everything in the house. So a lot of these are just common sense, to clean things, wash things, those kinds of things. Continuing that, eating healthy foods. Unfortunately with lead, because the way it works is it interferes with the development of your brain. So when you're 1 and 2 and even 5 and actually all the way up to 18 years old, your brain is still developing. And the way it does that is the different neurons create connections, and if they work, they keep them, and if it doesn't function, then they go back and they try others. So there's this ongoing connection, and that's how your brain develops. The lead gets in the way of doing that, so you get less connections. So a healthy brain has lots of connections. A less healthy brain has fewer connections. Because the lead gets in the way of making those connections, it interferes with the development of your brain. And unfortunately, you only get the one. You don't get to swap it out later. So that it is a permanent effect, it is lifelong, but by doing things like having a stimulating environment, having fresh food, these are good parenting recommendations anyway, but they become even more important when you're in a lead situation because that helps stimulate that brain development. And I've got a minute left. Oh, look at that, there's the last slide. So there is our vision, as to what we're shooting for. We will never be able to get that absolutely everyone everywhere, but frankly, that is the goal that we're shooting for as the department. Ha, take that. So with that, 10 minutes of questions. We'll start. That's up to them. Yes.
If a child picked that up and swallowed it.
Yes.
Will they pass that or will they
usually
absorb some of that lead?
They will absorb some of it. You'll get a real spike in the blood lead, and then as they pass it, with a fish sinker like that, that's small enough that generally will go all the way through. Actually, the problem with the Reebok charm is it was just big enough that it got stuck, and then it couldn't pass, and it was flu season, so the kid came in sick and they thought it was the flu. So there were lots of situations with that. But yeah, with a lead sinker, what you would get if you monitored their blood lead, it would be low, 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 and when he swallowed it, it would go up to here, and as soon as he passed it, it would slowly come down over the course of about 6 months or so. Yeah. So that's not good, but that's better than a long-term high exposure.
It's just a really quick question.
Yes, I just have a really quick question. Is there any regulations or laws surrounding imports of children's toys with lead?
Yes. In fact, Senator Klobuchar, right after this Reebok incident, passed a law that prohibits the importing of, you know, things that contain lead and the way they're manufactured, and they did pass that law. The challenge is, picture one of those container ships. Are you looking at every single one of those things?
So, I understand that fidget spinners are a big risk.
Well, it winds up in the weirdest places. Yeah. So the law's on the books. The challenge is, how do you actually, I mean, it sounds good. Yes, you should prevent it. Well, yeah. Well, you know, North Carolina passed a law against sea rise, too. It's like, well, good luck with that.
I actually have a question. Is there a calculation or a rule of thumb of how long to run the water? That was one of your suggestions of with idle water.
So how long to run the water depends on, so if you're in a home, it depends on do you have a lead service line? So then you want to let the water run until you get water that's from the main. So you may be running it anywhere from 30 seconds to a minute. You can also use sort of the, you know, let it run till it's cold plus an additional 30 seconds to get past any lead service line. So those are all some sort of guidances. If you can, the best way to do it is to let it run, test it, see if letting it run worked, and if you've let it run long enough. And usually 30 seconds for most houses without a lead service line is more than enough to get down to non-detect for lead.
And then, so applying that to then a commercial building or a school, for example, would the length of the lines is obviously longer for supply, so a longer run time would be necessary?
Right. So for a school, they have sort of a different procedure that they might be using if they're, so sometimes they may have an issue with only one tap, so maybe just that tap would need to be flushed. Sometimes a school will have a more widespread issue, so they might be doing flushing throughout the school building. So then they would start flushing with the tap that's closest to the main and then flush further out. And usually that could be anywhere from 2 to 10 minutes, and sort of the best way to know, again, would be to do a test afterwards just to make sure that the flushing is an appropriate response. Yep.
Are you aware of any instances where construction dust has that in old neighborhoods has caused spikes in levels of lead in people?
Yeah, if you talk to Minneapolis or St. Paul, when people are sandblasting their houses, we used to have a problem with the water towers, and now that's why you see those big curtains go up, because that tries to help prevent that. Because you still can have lead in industrial paint, because in theory it's not going to come in contact with children unless you, you know, sandblast it off a water tower. So it does happen on occasion, yeah.
And okay.
So, but the risk assessors, when they come in, you know, so when the child gets that elevated blood lead, they come in and look at all the different things, and they will look at all those exposure pathways. And in fact, when they see the neighbor with a, you know, sandblasting going on, it's like, well, you know, we know to include that.
Thank you very much.
Oh, this is fun, you guys. I'm in water now, and I was in lead for like 10 years. I haven't answered lead questions.
So fun. I have a couple questions. And so I know you posted the statute that was passed.
Right.
And maybe you covered it, and I just missed it. But is there a mandate on the frequency that public buildings have to test? I saw something about having a plan, but let's say, you know, if one plan is, oh, we'll test it every 10 years and, you know, another one says we'll test every 20, that counts? That's fine?
The law says every 5 years.
Okay.
That's as infrequent as that would be, so it would be at least every 5 years, and that's part of the reason after that required part, we kind of added the public health part, which if you have lead, we're strongly suggesting that you need to keep testing until you understand the problem and do something about it. So.
And that's just for schools?
Well, the law just applies to schools, yeah.
So any other, like, government building or public facility?
One step at a time.
Okay. My other question is, you mentioned that people could send in samples, and so, I mean, I have an idea about that, but I thought maybe it would be helpful if you could tell people, like, what that process would be like for their homes?
Well, do you want
to? So you would look up a lab that's in your area. So if you are looking at the Department of Health website, you can do a search for an accredited lab in Minnesota. And so you'd contact the lab of your choice, and then you would request a sample kit from them. And they will send you the sample bottle and instructions on how to sample. And it may depend on what you're looking for in a lead test. Sometimes you might use the 1 liter size bottle that a water system might use when they're looking for compliance in their system, especially if you have a lead service line. If you are thinking that lead is coming from a specific fixture, you might use a smaller 250 milliliter size bottle, like what we suggest a school use. And that's when you're looking at lead from a fixture, a source that's close to where you'd be drinking the water. So you would contact the lab, they'll send you the sample kit, you would collect the sample and send it back to the lab, and they'll send you the results.
Okay, and is there a cost associated with that?
Yep, so every lab, the cost could be different, so you can shop around to try and find the one that works for you, and usually the cost might be between 20 and 50, depending on all the specific analyses you request.
Per sample?
Per sample, yep.
Thanks.
For comparison, a PFC sample costs us $1,500 per, so. Okay, our summary message is, lead is bad.
Thank you, Daniel and Anna. Our next topic is bullying prevention. Sadie Cunningham from Canvas Health will speak about bullying. Her position with Canvas Health's Abuse Response Services is as a sexual violence advocate. She is currently pursuing her master's degree in social work. After graduating from Minnesota State University Mankato, she worked in a domestic violence shelter providing services to women and children, and also while working for Canvas Health ARS nights and weekends. Her true passion is in prevention, education, and advocating for social justice.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. So my name is Sadie Cunningham, and I work for Canvas Health. My topic to address tonight is bullying prevention. So as I said, I work for Canvas Health. As you may or may not know, Canvas Health has a large variety of programs, mostly consisting of mental health and chemical health programming. I work specifically out of the Abuse Response Service Program. And so that is a sexual violence program serving all of Washington County. We are the only sexual violence agency within the county available. So we offer a variety of services through this program. We operate a 24-hour crisis line for victims, survivors of sexual violence or dating violence. We offer an adult support group. We offer counseling services, medical and legal advocacy. We also do community education. I spend a lot of my time doing community education. So like I'm doing today, whether it's addressing the public or certain organizations, I also spend a lot of time in Washington County schools doing education, mostly consisting of topics related to sexual violence, consent, healthy relationships, sex trafficking, and sexting. And then we also do school-based services, so offering one-to-one support for victim survivors who self-identify within the school system. So feel free to ask any questions related to our program towards the end. Okay, so when we talk about bullying, most of us probably have a good idea of what that means. Our textbook definition would be unwanted and aggressive behavior, words or actions that are directed towards another person. And typically this is including a real or perceived imbalance of power. And I'll talk a little bit more about what that looks like. And also we know that this behavior is typically not one instance. It's something that is often repeated. or is happening on more than one occasion. So when discussing the imbalance of power, when it comes to bullying or really any type of violence, again, this could be real or perceived, where the person being bullied is perceived to have less power or control than the person bullying. And so there are different factors that can lead to people believing that they have more power over another person, whether that's real or perceived. So that could be physical size or strength. If somebody feels that they are stronger, better, faster, that may resort to them feeling more inclined to bully another person. If they're more popular, they have access to embarrassing information. This is something that we see a lot more common with youth, especially older youth, whether that's an opportunity to spread a rumor with embarrassing information about someone or to share a photo that's embarrassing of someone. That opportunity is being seen a lot more when it comes to bullying within older youth. And then I say behind the screen. So often we're seeing bullying take forms online as well. And so being behind the screen is giving youth a sense of security. Maybe if they wouldn't say something or address something to someone in person, they'd feel more confident addressing or saying something online or through social media. So there's a very fine line when it comes to bullying and harassment and whether different behaviors could be considered just general bullying or when they come more common, they correlate with the law and harassment. So we identify harassment as unwelcome behavior as well, just like bullying, but typically this is based on a protected class. So of the few listed here, it could also include gender or sexual orientation, different protected classes that often experience or are at higher risk for experiencing bullying. In order to be considered harassment, it must be a behavior that is severe, pervasive, or persistent. So it's something that is happening on a consistent basis. It's not typically one instance. And it's something that has to create a hostile environment. So whether that's a child not feeling comfortable taking the bus to school because that environment is often hostile or uncomfortable for them, or they don't feel comfortable accessing different areas of the school because they experience bullying in those certain areas, spending time at in the cafeteria at lunch. This could take a variety of different forms. But again, it's that fine line between addressing behavior that's either bullying or could be considered harassment. So like I said before, cyberbullying is something that we're seeing more and more common. Typically, this is something that could be considered bullying, but it happens online, through social media, through texting. It's something that spreads a lot faster than face-to-face interactions. So more people have access to, if it's an embarrassing photo or embarrassing information, or hate speech. This can take a lot of different forms. And there's typically a wider audience, right? So maybe somebody might not hear this rumor at school, but they hear it online, and then it's spread beyond that. And it's not something that stops at school, right? Most youth, when they have access to technology, especially older youth, they have that technology throughout the day or after school. They take it home with them. They have access to social media. So it's something that creates more of a hostile situation when it's following them home. You may not be able to read these specific examples, but again, there are different forms of cyberbullying. So whether that's sending mean texts, posting fight videos, threatening or harassing comments, creating fake profiles to bully or intimidate other people, to make threats. It's something that we're seeing more and more common. So a lot of people want to know what the risk factors are. Of course, there are certain populations that are at higher risk for experiencing bullying. But really what it comes down to is these different factors. What are the factors of the individual that may put them at higher risk for bullying? whether that's like their personal values, the way they function in social environments, et cetera. How does their family function, and what are the family values? What do they learn at home? How does that play a role in how they're treated at school or on social media outside of school? What is the school environment? How does that play a factor in bullying or harassment? Is it something that's being addressed within schools? Is it something that is commonly happening in schools? This can all play a role in people's risk for being bullied or harassed. And also with their peers, right? We know a lot about peer pressure and popularity and feeling the need to fit in and be able to socially interact with other people in a positive and healthy way. Are our peers encouraging that healthy behavior, or are they not? Are we feeling pressured to maintain a certain status or maintain certain friendships and therefore bullying another person? Typically bullying, we often believe that it includes two people, the person being bullied and the person bullying. Often there are more involved people in the group. So people who recognize this behavior but don't know how to step in, or recognize this behavior and do nothing, or they give into the behavior as well because they want to maintain a certain social status, or because they feel that they have that imbalance of power. And lastly, the community. What does our community do to address bullying, to address harassment? These risk factors are very general, and it could go for bullying, it could go for sexual harassment, sexual violence, relationship violence, really anything related. So there are also significant risk factors. So based on research, we know that people with learning disabilities or ADHD, autism, people who speak different languages other than English, people who are overweight or underweight, have specific healthcare needs, or identify as LGBTQ, are at higher risk for experiencing bullying. And so these marginalized populations often, of course, are at higher risk for bullying, but also for more hostile or intimidating behavior that could also be considered harassment by law. So what is the impact of all this? What is the impact of bullying on a person? What is the impact of harassment? We know that it can put children at risk or youth at risk for experiencing mental health issues. So you're at higher risk for experiencing depression, anxiety, other mental health issues if you are a victim of bullying, harassment, etc. And then especially with harassment, creating that hostile environment, it can lead to youth doing more poorly in school, lower academic achievement. If they're not feeling safe in their school environment, how are they supposed to succeed in that environment? So it raises a lot of different questions about the prevention piece. And some of these, the impact of bullying, we know is rather self-explanatory, right? Feeling low self-esteem, different insecurities, rejection, exclusion as a result of bullying. Often this can lead to internalizing problems, which often also unfortunately invite bullying, right? If somebody is lacking that perceived power or control, and it's very obvious to another student, that also makes them a target for harassment or bullying. So how do we identify bullying victims versus somebody who may not be experiencing bullying but needs other support services? It's rather difficult, but really it comes down to communicating with youth and asking them what's going on with you, what's happening, are you okay, et cetera, and then connecting them with the right support services. We know that typically, if it's creating a hostile environment because of bullying or harassment, youth are going to do more poorly in school, right? They're not going to feel comfortable in different school environments, riding the bus to school. They may resort to unhealthy coping mechanisms with experiencing with alcohol or drugs or vaping. maybe if it's something that's related to cyberbullying, they're withdrawing from their device a little bit. They're limiting their use of technology, which would probably be a really big red flag in this day and age. Maybe they bring weapons to school, et cetera. Withdrawing from family and friends. So often the media talks a lot about bullying when we see storylines of youth and suicide. Of course, bullying, putting people who experience bullying are put at risk for mental health issues. Persistent bullying can lead to socio-emotional issues. But the vast majority of young people who are bullied do not become suicidal. The media often portrays that differently. So often they're saying, you know, specifically if youth do die by suicide, it's because of bullying specifically. Although that can happen, of course, most people who die by suicide have multiple risk factors. There's more than one thing going on. It's not solely bullying. The CDC has done some great research on this. I encourage you all to check out that information. There are some handouts here as well for you to check out. And then again, those marginalized populations. So youth who identify as LGBTQ are at higher risk for suicide, even when bullying is not a factor. So that's something to be aware of as well, especially when a lot of our perceptions do come from the media and those messages that we receive in that form. Okay, so we'll switch gears a little bit to prevention. What can we do to prevent bullying? When it comes to cyberbullying, set expectations for the behavior. So when youth are receiving a device, when they're going to have access to social media, encourage privacy settings. Discuss why privacy settings are beneficial. Take the time to really educate yourselves on the social media and the different things that people are using or youth are using devices for. Ask them to verify their accounts of the people that they are accepting as friends. I always say that if somebody cannot approach another person face to face, or they cannot ask them through text message, hey, is this your account? You shouldn't have them on social media. Reporting is always an option through social media. Whether it's hate speech or threats, whatever is being done on social media, you can report that. You can report that through the social media app. You can report, encourage reporting to a trusted adult. Do not respond or retaliate. Often that can just escalate behavior. If we engage in retaliation or responding to harassment or threats or bullying online, typically the person who is bullying will take advantage of that and the behavior will escalate. So we really want to avoid that retaliation. Save the evidence, right? So we know so often on devices, different apps will advertise that things disappear forever. That's not necessarily the case, right? The internet is a very deep web of a lot of information. So save that information, save the evidence, or encourage youth to save the evidence so that they can tell somebody or report it. Monitor their behavior and encourage them to seek support, right, or to tell somebody. Setting consequences for behavior, modeling good behavior is really important, right? If we know about the apps that we're using, we know how to model that behavior, we're just going to be setting an example for our youth. If we're disengaged from that aspect of their lives, then we're not going to really know what's going on or act as an adult that may have an interest in what's going on through social media. A focus on social climate. So what can we do in society, in our everyday norms, or to change norms of cyberbullying, to change our behavior in treating people as equals? That's kind of grand scheme. There are a lot of different ways in which we could do this. But creating those safe environments is what's really going to help youth and also know that this behavior is unacceptable. conduct bullying assessments. So stopbullying.gov has some really great toolkits to help conduct bullying assessments, to conduct a survey and see, you know, what types of bullying are more frequently observed? Where is this happening? Is there significant resources available on specific topics? This is really comprehensive approach, but having an assessment done can raise awareness and also create a baseline of knowledge so people understand that this is something that is happening at this rate and what have our prevention efforts done in some time. Coordination of prevention efforts. So again, this is not just a one-person job, right? What can we do to involve others? What can we do as a multidisciplinary team, utilizing more than one resource? There are a lot of different agencies, a lot of different people with different expertise. What can we do to engage all of them in this effort? And also encourage teachers and people who work with youth frequently to be able to recognize bullying and how to address and train them on how to address it on the spot. And when you do address it, what are the consequences going to be? What does school policy say in regards to bullying, in regards to harassment? How are we going to handle those consequences at home? Following through with that and offering support services for either the person being bullied or the person who is bullying, if that is something that they may need. So again, this just reiterates the importance of an integrated prevention effort, right? So seeking people from different areas of expertise. So one example of that could be the safety committee. You have somebody who is from administration, a teacher, a bus driver. Having diverse perspectives is going to be really important. And lastly, educate, right? We want to talk to our youth about bullying. We want to talk to them about how we treat other people. Treat people how you want to be treated. What does that look like? What are some examples of that? Build empathy within them and also give them the skills to have some self-reflection, right? There are a lot of different reasons, whether it's the imbalance of power or wanting to maintain a social status that people might give into bullying. That doesn't necessarily make them a bad person, but how can you self-reflect on that behavior and identify how you want to treat other people going forward? Know your local resources. So invite education into the schools, into your home. Use media or movies as a way to start conversations in the home. You watch a family movie and there's some behavior that is unacceptable or would be considered bullying, address it during that movie and say, hey, like, I recognize this. This is not something that I would ever want somebody to do to me, etc. And socio-emotional learning as well is really important. And I believe Stillwater School District is working towards developing those standards within lower grade levels. So really focusing on that socio-emotional learning and that those behaviors. Okay, do we have any questions?
I'll ask one.
So you were making, you had two different slides on the differences between bullying and harassment.
Mm-hmm.
So if a student is experiencing something somewhere in there
mm-hmm.
and it doesn't quantify or classify as harassment,
mm-hmm.
other than their parental or the teacher, there's nothing actually protecting them unless there is a school policy or a member of the staff that's going to be representing them?
Yeah, so yeah, it depends. Whether it is a member of staff or through parental supervision, you can contact other people's parents. Typically, there is a school policy. So as a parent, you're the advocate for your children, right? Advocate when it comes to the school faculty and what you can do in those ways to push for either policy that's more specific or for consequences of bullying. And also, one thing I forgot to mention, too, is like other peer education, peer support. So students or youth tend to receive messages much better from other youth. So encouraging that dialogue with your youth or specific youth that are interested in these topics and enforcing it in that way.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so on one of your slides, you had the thing about with cyberbullying, don't respond, you know, don't respond or do it online.
Yep.
You remember Back to the Future when the guy, he confronts the bully, like in person, and it kind of ends the bullying? Is it more effective than if you are being cyberbullied to confront the person the next time you see them and say, hey, it's enough of that? Or is it better just to ignore it? I mean, if you're being bullied, I know you don't want to fight it out online, but is it better to confront it in person, or is that not effective at all?
I don't know if there's really a correct answer there. I don't think necessarily that we want to address it in person, because again, that retaliation piece, typically when it comes to bullying or harassment with that imbalance of power, a person who is bullying another is going to feed off of that energy, and getting a reaction is going to encourage them to be more aggressive or more hostile. So when it comes to cyberbullying, like reporting it online, reporting hateful comments or hate speech, something like that, you can do that online. If it's in person, it's difficult to say. I think reporting, it's difficult because sometimes we encourage youth to work problems out themselves first. But having the conversation that, as a trusted adult, I'm here for you in these situations and I will advocate on your behalf, I think is more important, because you don't want to risk that escalation.
I'm going to piggyback off that. Are the software companies and app developers going to be held accountable or be needing to abide by any standards to respond to reports when somebody does report, like, for example, Facebook, a hateful post, and you have the option of, like, reporting that post? Are there actually any regulations on what they need to do to respond or how to act to that?
I'm not aware of any specific regulations. They all have their own policies and related to what they allow, what content they allow, and what they don't. Typically, they're pretty comprehensive on not allowing, like, hate speech and threats made. But again, they're not going to be monitoring for those, so they do have to be reported. And then the consequences, I think, vary depending when a report is made. It's just one way to delay or maybe take that first step in addressing the behavior, and then if it continues, you would maybe need to seek more support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sadie. Our next topic is student and teacher safety. We have Rachel Bugbee here to speak. She's a District 834 parent and community member, and she was a special ed paraprofessional for 6 years at Afton Lakeland Elementary School.
So my name is Rachel Bugbee, as she said, and I am a community member, a parent, and a former special ed paraprofessional for District 834. I am no expert in this field. I am here based on personal experience and to speak on behalf of current teachers, paraprofessionals, nurses, and staff who feel that if they speak up, they will be retaliated against by our administration in the form of letters of discipline in their personnel files and intimidation. When you get home from work, being hit, slapped, kicked, sworn at, spit on, hair pulled, probably aren't your words to describe your day, unless you are a cop, a prison guard, or a nurse, but certainly not a teacher or school support. Well, this is now the new normal for many of the people working in our schools. Let me be very clear. This is not just a Stillwater Area Public School issue. This is happening all over the country. We have a mental health issue, as described by Sadie and many other people. We also have a discipline and consequence issue. What I am here to bring to light is how those issues are physically, mentally, and emotionally affecting our teachers and staff. not to mention the toll it takes on our kids who witness the destructive behavior towards adults with little or no consequence. So these are some of the examples of current issues during this particular school year. And it's mainly focused in the elementary schools, most of these examples that I have. We have paras and teachers going to the doctor daily to document bites, scratches, and bruises. We have teachers being verbally abused by students as young as kindergarten daily, up to high school as well. We have elementary children leaving school grounds with those incidents not being reported to the police. We have stools, chairs, and desks being thrown in the classroom in fits of rage while there are children still in the classrooms. We have kids throwing scissors, pencils, and anything they can get their hands on in schools, in the classrooms. We have paras being hit and kicked by kids daily. So what is the policy for staff safety? As of last year, there was not really any. Some wonder why we are having a substitute shortage issue. The answer is clear. The substitutes know they have no support from the principals and administration, and these troubled kids have even less respect for substitutes. So are these incidents being recorded and followed through on? The incident report flow is as follows. An incident happens, it's supposed to be reported to the principal. They provide an intervention plan. It's reported to human resources. That intervention plan is then put into a personnel file or as it becoming a part of an incident. So what do we do about that? How do we make the teachers feel that they are protected? So again, this is happening all over our country. This isn't specific to Stillwater. But it's being compounded right now by us by a lack of support for our staff. And our staff has nowhere to go and no one to talk to and no one to give them any help. And so that's why I'm here. That's what I'm talking about. And that's all I have.
I'm going to ask one. Since Sadie's sitting right next to you, are you comfortable piping in right now, Sadie?
Yeah, absolutely.
How do the slides that you gave us about students and how they should react and where those boundaries are when you take that to the level of the teacher, when you define if it's, is the teacher being bullied by a student, or is the teacher being assaulted, or is the teacher being harassed? Have you seen any development in that?
That's tough for me to answer. Not necessarily my area of expertise. I believe that it's happening. I'm not sure specifically what policy there is related to that, or what the most effective way would be to address it.
Right. So if we generalize that just to an adult, since you do have a background in other forms of abuse and harassment, just in a general sense, do you suggest that a person, whether it's a teacher or a mother or a wife or whatever role you play as an adult, what kind of resources they would have or what you suggest for them?
Mm-hmm.
That different than for a child?
Yeah, well, I think addressing the issue and prevention is really important. So being able to do that in the first place, but also finding support elsewhere. So whether that's through people who have similar experiences, that advocacy or self-advocacy is really important. So taking opportunities like this to speak on the issue and address the school administration is really important. Beyond that, finding peer or colleague-to-colleague support.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm sorry about all of that. I guess I'm curious, like, what happened? Because when I was in school, I mean, I can remember very specific kids who did very specific things, and the teachers just did not tolerate that at all. And so it never, never would have escalated to some of the actions you're talking about. So I'm just kind of, like, where did it fall apart? Like, why did the discipline policies change? Did the suspension policies change? Like, what happened that kids can be so violent and there's not some sort of recourse, you know, that keeps happening? Is it, what happened?
Well, that's a really good question, and isn't that the crux of it? Mm-hmm. When did this really start coming around? I don't know. Like I say, I'm not an expert. I just know what it, the teacher's hands are tied. And so, I think that it's not just teachers. I think there's a lot of disciplines where their hands are tied. And so there's only so much we can do, or they can do. And I think that there's a lot of parents who are hands-off. And I think that that's hard on the district. I think that's hard on the administration. I think that's hard on teachers. I think that's hard on in all areas. That there's a lot of parents who aren't connected to their kids. And we, you know, it needs to start at the home, and I think we need to encourage that somehow in the schools, starting in preschool, starting in kindergarten, and all the way through. We want our parents to be connected with our kids, the kids, and then in turn that helps the teachers have support from the parents to report some of these things that are happening, and up it goes. I think that the administration wants to do what's right for kids. But I, you know, there's just a lot of things that are happening socially and that contribute to this, I think.
So on the parent element, as a staff member, if it were me, just for example, am I prevented from talking to a parent about their child's behavior? Or on the bullying end of it, because I feel like I heard some sort of school something or other, and if there was a bullying situation, that it wasn't necessarily a guarantee that the kid who was being bullied or had been harmed, that their family would be notified, but more so that this behavioral support services should be provided for the bully, but not so much for the kid who's being bullied. And so I'm wondering how that works for you. You know what I mean? Like, there's this thing and it happens, and so you report it, and there's supposed to be a protocol of things that happen. But is there leverage for you to talk to parents? I know it's not you currently, mm-hmm. right? But right. As a staff person, to go and talk to parents and then to crack that out without administration? Or is that just not happening?
I don't believe that that's true. I think it needs to, there's a policy that needs to be followed. I don't know that the parent can go directly to the student or to the family. I don't know how that works.
Hmm. Got it. Sorry.
My name's Nisha Anderson, and I was a classroom teacher before I started staying home with my girls, and I was physically assaulted by a student one of my first years teaching. And just knowing firsthand of that situation, and I mean, through the 7 years I taught, there were situations just like you said. And what I think is so eye-opening to our community is hearing this, because when we hear things about that are going on in my child's school now in Stillwater, and moms are talking or dads are talking, they're shocked.
Right.
And I'm not shocked, because I saw it. And they don't know these things are happening in the schools, and they can't believe it, because just like someone said earlier, we remember the one or two situations when we were young, but this didn't happen, and why isn't it, why does it seem to be more prevalent now? And My question is, do any of the staff people that you've spoken with have suggestions of a plan of where we could go? Because I know this is uncharted territory, mm-hmm. because we didn't have this. Mm-hmm. But I know there are school board members here. Mm-hmm. Are there any ideas for where we could go with this to help support our staff and students feel safe? Because like you said, they can't learn unless they feel safe.
Right. Right.
And how can a teacher focus on teaching our kids?
Right.
If they don't feel safe.
Right. I think that there's a stigma from what I've people that I've talked to, the teachers, there's a stigma. They don't. It's not something we talk about. Mm-hmm. We don't want to bring attention to it. It puts a bad mark on our system. It puts a bad mark on our schools. There's not an outlet for them to talk. Mm-hmm. There's nowhere for them to go. All they can do is talk with amongst themselves in the lunchroom, or go home and talk to their families at night. And they're broken. Mm-hmm. The teachers and the staff are broken. And I would love to see if we could get an outlet for them, a Survey Monkey. A place for them to talk about what we don't want to talk about. I never knew that this was happening until I worked in the schools. Mm-hmm. When I went my kids were in elementary school and I went to volunteer every week for an hour or a half hour, you don't see this happening. And until you're there and you're walking in the hallways and you're getting to know these kids and who they are and what their family situations are, you really have no idea the depth of despair some of these kids are in. Mm-hmm. And they have nowhere to let that go. Mm-hmm. And so of course, sometimes it comes out in schools. Sometimes they love we hurt the ones that we love the most, right? Mm-hmm. And so, and some of these kids, those teachers are they're only people. Mm-hmm. They're only consistent people. And so, I think from what I've heard is that the teachers don't have a voice, and they don't have anywhere to talk about what's happening. And we don't want to talk about it. And so I wish that my hope is that I know that the reason I'm here is because I know people who can't. They have PTSD and they can't, they can barely walk into the schools because they're so traumatized by what they've been through. That's crazy.
And we're going to lose good teachers because of this.
Excellent.
And these students with so many mental health needs aren't going to have the teachers to support
and
them.
And you can look at that with the substitutes. Mm-hmm. That's why we have a hard time finding substitute teachers, because it's very, very difficult to walk into a classroom mm-hmm. when they know what they're coming into. Mm-hmm. And it's hard to walk into a classroom every day mm-hmm. when you know what you're coming into. And there is not a place for these teachers to talk about what's happening, and we need to find a place for them to do that.
Thank you for speaking on behalf of them.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. Our next topic is emergency response, and we have the Oak Park Heights Police Department here. Oak Park Heights Police Department provides overall public safety response in the city, as well as provides the following services to the community: community outreach events, compliance checks, welfare checks, animal control, and supporting neighboring agencies. Another such service is providing an investigator school resource officer at the Stillwater Area High School. This position is a full-time assignment for the officer during the school year. The chief of police is the certified emergency manager for Oak Park Heights and oversees training compliance, mitigation coordination, and response coordination. In the event of a disaster or other significant emergency, the police chief provides for overall management and coordination of city operations and the assisting services, including fire, paramedics, public works, and civilian agencies such as Red Cross. And I'll allow our speakers to introduce themselves by name, because we weren't quite sure, since they're police officers and they could have an emergency at any time, we weren't quite sure which police officers would be with us.
I am Brian DeRozier. I'm the police chief of the city of Oak Park Heights, and this is Officer Paradise. She does work as our SRO at the high school. I will give you just kind of a quick overview or a brief synopsis, if you will, on what our response would be. This is directed towards the school. The school does have its own emergency management plan, just like Anderson Windows or any other corporation or entity that would have that. The city has an emergency plan of itself. So the police department does not develop those plans for those entities, nor do we develop it for the school. The school has done a very good job, and it's an evolving process, and I think they meet the best practices that are there and probably exceed most of those practices. Our students are really very safe. Our response in the event of whether it be a bomb threat or some other physical threat to the school is really going to be dependent upon that threat. I can't give you a hard and fast, we will do this, we will do that. What have we done in preparation? All of our officers, and I think almost every officer in Washington County is an entity, whether it's Woodbury Police Department, Oakdale, we have a group that we have formed under the Emergency Management Operations for Washington County, kind of oversees it and runs it for us. But we do training, and that includes the fire department and EMS. They work with us. We all train together so that in an event, at the high school, you're not going to get just Oak Park Heights Police Department. We don't have the resources. Washington County does not have the resources. Woodbury, that you're going to get the army, if you will, that will show up. So that including fire, EMS, police, all the different responses. We're there, we take control of a situation, and we work with the school on dealing with their plan, on what they will and what they need to do. The students are their responsibilities. We're there to control the situation and provide that overall safety and stop any incident that's happening, whether it be a criminal incident, fire, or EMS, some other situation like that. So, is there anything I can answer for you, I guess? That's kind of a general overview of what we do or don't. Yep, I apologize for that if it's overly broad, but it is such an encompassing subject, and I can't talk specific incidents, but we'll do the best we can if you have questions.
So you said that entities have their own emergency plan, Anderson Windows, the schools, whatever. Do you review those plans with them, and how often do you review so you know what the plan is for the various entities?
The school district, we worked with them during the implementation of their plan. They had a private company come in and use some grant funding and that specialized in developing those plans. So we worked with them and determined, is this realistic for this area versus New York City? There'd be a totally different response and the number of people they can draw and we can draw and things like that. So yeah, we do work with that. I do have a copy of their plan. And we review that plan just like I do with Walmart's plan for their hazardous materials.
That was my question. Is that they're reviewed and updated, and you're working in conjunction to say, as threats evolve and change.
Correct.
What was a threat 40 years ago is not the same as the threats today.
Yeah, we do. And actually, we were just talking about it, that's something that's been planned, and we're trying to coordinate. School district has Woodbury, Washington County, Bayport, Stillwater, and Oak Park Heights. We're trying to coordinate a bunch of people together, get times and dates together so we can have that meeting and go over that again. But yeah, Lindsay attends a school safety meeting once a month.
Every month we do that. Yep, we're admin, myself, like the head of every department, custodial, the lunch to nurse to science. To me, there is an independent security team there as well, hired by the school, and they are with that as well. So we all meet once a month to go over concerns, things being brought up, and things like that. We do that every morning. Tomorrow morning, actually. Thanks for reminding me.
Hello. My question is, what are the duties of the investigator school resource officer at Stillwater area high school?
Well, I could start off in that we have a two-page agreement that we worked out with the school on those responsibilities and duties. But generally, she's our law enforcement representative at the school. Whether so we're not sending an individual to respond all the time. She's there. She knows the school, knows the staff, knows the students. Works very well in that regards. But she will handle everything from simple student disruptions to crimes that happen at the school.
And it's a daily thing. Like I said, you're working with counselors. Like I said, individual kids will come up to me with concerns, and I'll bring it to the counselor. They don't feel comfortable doing it that way. I mean, from unlocking their car because they locked the keys in the car to different threats and different things that we've dealt with over the years. I mean, from every, they bring up concerns at home, but they bring it to school because we're comfortable talking about it at school. Things like that. It depends. I'm trying to be a very good counselor while I'm there. Like I said, you become a different cop when you are at the school. Like I said, some officers don't realize, what it takes to work at the school, but you really do become a better cop. And I like being there because it really shows kids that cops just aren't this robot on the side of the road that just, what's your license, proof of insurance, and very straightforward. They realize that cops are human. You can sit down and talk to me if you need to. And that's why that's the biggest thing is building those relationships. And like I said, you're dealing with so many different things in a given day. So it just depends. It's busy, very busy. Like I said, some of it isn't law enforcement related, where you're working with your counselors and your principals. Like some of the bullying things that she brought up, it gets brought up with the school. And sometimes we sit down, like you said, we're talking about it. We sit down with each individual person. I'll be there talking as well with the counselor or the principal. We kind of talk it out loud. So, and anything and everything you've dealt with at the school.
I have a question. So you have a relationship with the teachers or with the counselors and with the students. Is there also an existing or a potential for a relationship with the teachers and faculty also for their needs?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I have teachers coming up to me as well.
Great.
From things that you have discussed and things like that we bring up with administration. I have just as close relationships with the teachers, and that bring concerns to me. I said, even if we can't, if there isn't a legal side to it, we can at least document it and then talk about it with the admin too. I always encourage, even with the kids, even if it's not something we can act on with the law enforcement side, at least they can talk to me about it and we can document it. Kind of creating that paper trail later on, just so it's documented somewhere. So.
Okay.
I have a quick question. So you are finding that kids will come up and speak with you, and there's not a stigma. I mean, they feel comfortable, or mm-hmm. Has that grown over time?
Oh yeah. My first year there, like of course I work nights before then. I come into the school and I'm like, it's just you gotta build that. And now this is my fourth school year, and it's like I said, I've changed as a cop over the last 4 years, and it's for the good. Like I said, every cop should go through the mm-hmm. SRO program. Like I said, when you're on the street, you don't deal with the kids at school. You deal with them when they're shenanigans on the streets or at home. You get to see them at school, 8 hours a day. You build that relationship. So, yeah, absolutely. Okay.
So I have a few questions, so someone can cut me off if I'm just going on too long. But with some of the things that Rachel brought up, can you give like an estimation? Because I hear about things in high school, like an estimation of like maybe how many incidents like that happen a week with like students on staff conflict?
How many are reported to me and how many I can't give you an exact.
I guess how many you deal with. I know it's just ballpark.
Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to think like this. I mean, it really depends. I can't, like I said, I can't give you an exact, like I said, if I even know about them half time or I hear about them after the fact if something happens. But, I can think of maybe a dozen different incidents this year that I've heard about, especially with the special ed program. You said like the hair pulling. That one is, I hear about a lot. And
things like that. And if you hear about the, you know, where kids get that upset or they're so angry, you know, where it's that different, just a different kid in general, you get that a lot. And I'd say I have maybe about 12 this year.
Okay.
And those are hearing about after the fact and like, okay, you know. But again, that, I hope they're handled, you know, with the administration and things being brought up.
So those are things you said that you've heard about after the fact, but you haven't had to be involved or legally take to other arenas?
Not to the legal realm, within like staff and students and things like that.
Okay. So there was an email that came out from administration talking about, with the whole Florida situation, see something, say something. And so if a student were to say something to administration or teachers or whatnot, then is there some sort of something in place where then that is then given to you and then you guys determine the severity of it, or is that up to them?
Probably we correlate between the two.
Yeah, we've had several incidents even recently with this, and there's an ultra awareness now. So we just had one not too long ago. Mm-hmm. Generally what happens is either Lindsay gets it directly or goes through the school, and they're in immediate contact with us. We don't make the decision that schools will close or stay open. That's a school decision. We work with the school administration and try to determine as quickly as we can what the situation is. Sometimes with social media, and Lindsay can talk about some of the different apps that are out there, but it becomes very difficult to try and backtrack some of that and time consuming. But our primary objective is to work with the school, work in the incident, and determine if there is or is not a threat, and work from there. The ultimate outcome of whether someone would be charged with something, that can be several months in process by the time we serve search warrants to some of these app providers and try and get the data back from them, if they give it to us at all.
Okay.
Sometimes they just out and already ignore us.
That's fun. So you are Oak Park Heights, and then you take care of the high school.
Yep.
And then am I understanding that Washington County has Oakland?
Yep.
So Oakland, then is Stillwater then Stillwater?
Yep, like Stillwater Junior High. It's Stillwater officer.
Sure.
Works there.
Yep. And so it's just one in each building?
Yep, one okay. in each building. And we all coordinate. We all meet every couple months. We all get together. So the end of this of March, we're having a meeting all getting together, kind of talking about the recent with everything with Florida and kind of different things that each school has dealt with. So just to, and we all communicate on email just to, because we all experience the same problems, obviously, so.
Sure, okay. And then my last one, I don't have kids who are high school age even, you know, but we hear lots of rumors through the community about kind of a significant drug issue in Stillwater. And I'm just wondering what that looks like from your perspective. Are they just like really that sneaky and this cannot be found, or like what's the deal there?
I guess I'm busy. I deal with like, you know, that 10% of the population I deal with 90% of the time, just like out on the streets. You know, you talk to that 10%, it's according to them, everybody in Stillwater smokes weed, everybody uses wax, everybody, you know, takes Xanax. That's a 10%. Like you get, again, as that 10% of the population, when a majority, like I said, when I get to deal with the nice, decent kids that don't abuse drugs or alcohol, that they're just like, oh, you know, just like, oh, it's refreshing almost, because I'm constantly dealing with that 10%. So it's out there. Like, I encourage you guys to look up, you know, what does marijuana wax look like? All the new e-cigarettes, all the vape stuff. Look up this stuff, because a lot of the new e-cigs don't look like old e-cigs. Do you guys know what e-cigs are? Yeah, like the new ones look like little jump drives.
USB things, yeah.
Yeah, they look like in the last like probably 3 weeks, I think I've probably gotten 8 or 9 of them. Like, they just completely, but a lot of teachers don't know what they are. So, oh, it's just a battery charger or something like that. But I just encourage people to look up this stuff, look up these accounts, monitor the kids' accounts as much as you can, ask about spam accounts. Yeah, all these kids have spam accounts because they know their parents are monitoring one account. So they create these fake ones. So ask them about it. They won't tell you, or they'll make a new one. but I monitor. I have all the lovely fake accounts, and I kind of monitor as many of them as I can.
You're a troll.
The admin know.
You gotta do what you gotta do. I'm not judging you.
The admin know that I do have those, and they're like, you know, so.
Right.
And if I see something, they'll bring it up, and we'll.
Good. That's good. Okay, so with you talked about those are the jewel things, right? That's what those little thingies are, the USB-looking jump drives?
Is that what they call them? I haven't heard that one. Jewel. Okay.
So is that an arrestable thing?
City ordinance, any use of any tobacco devices against city ordinance or permits in schools. So we can deal with that, and we do. We regularly take away the cigarettes and the tobacco devices, and trust me, the kids don't like it. We pay away.
That's what they always ask.
$100 e-cigarette. Yeah. They get very upset.
They always ask if a parent, a lot of these kids, 15, 16 years old, I ask if their parents know there's vaping. Yeah. You know, a lot of the parents know, and some of the parents are okay with it. And then, you know, they say, well, it's better than smoking weed, things like that. But, you know, these things are going, like you said, 40, 60, 80 bucks. And that's what they say. Can my parent just come pick it up? No, why not? You know, they just get so mad at that. It's like, if you had alcohol, I can't have your parent come pick up your alcohol. It's like, no, please. But
the school does take, you know, the other end of that scenario of what's being done about it. And then, yeah, I guess, you know, number one is let's be realistic, is they are young adults, and they have that mindset of young adults. And I'm not sure what the total count is at this point, but 3,000, something like that. So we have a small city out there, and the school does take a proactive approach. They bring in a canine unit several times a year, and goes through blockers and the school and throughout in the parking lot, some of those things. Our hands are tied to some respect. We can't be involved in that. There's some legal issues with those things. The school does that on their own. So we can't tell them to go do this. So there is a proactive approach. But the overall, there's this huge drug problem. I don't, not at the school, Lindsay's at the school, but I really just, I don't think it's probably any worse than when you and I were in school. Unfortunately, I think the drugs have shifted, and which is concerning. You know, we deal with that, and we're seeing the Xanax and the Zanzibars and all the nicknames the kids have for some of this stuff. And we've seen some incidents with those, and it's unfortunate because they step into that 2 feet first and don't realize that it's, you know, it's significant an incident is what it is. So, but I think, you know, whether it's a law enforcement problem, whether it's a school problem, or whether it's a societal problem, is, you know, something that we kind of have to look at in the big picture here, too. So.
Okay. And the health department can weigh in. If your kids tell you that vaping is safe, we do not concur with that opinion.
They say, though, there's nothing wrong with it. It's all vape, safe. It's just vapor. It's not bad.
Strawberry, how could that be toxic?
Yeah.
So, actually, it's a concern because the little bottles they get to put in the thing actually contain a lethal dose of nicotine. And they've already had a kid in Oklahoma who, because it smelled like strawberry, took the little thing. So, yeah, it's a problem.
Okay, so my last question. You said that the district has an independent security team. So what do they do that's different than you?
So it's a hired, it's your KIPS. KIP security, if I remember right. Yep, and so we have three of them there. Two are full-time, one's part-time. And they're not armed. They wear uniforms, things like that, but they're not armed in any way. They have no weapons. They're more so hall monitors, and they're more like my eyes. Like, they work like the parking lot part with the school and their parking permits, all that stuff. They monitor that part. But then they're a lot of better eyes. Like, they're walking around constantly. They know the kids just as well as I do. They know their cars just as well as I do. Like, hey, Billy, I know you're not in front. Like, they know the kids just as well as I do. Know where they're supposed to be and things like that. So they're more kind of hall monitors. Like, they just kind of, they go to the halls. They pick up kids if administration needs them. They can go bring kids back and forth, things like that.
And then, okay, I lied. This is my last question. This is happening, and this is great, and this will be aired, and people can watch this, but if things like this aren't happening, is there a way that you guys sort of communicate to the community or to parents tapes, those USBs aren't USBs? Like, is there a some sort of notification where people can check in and be like, oh, there's the newest drug. That's nice.
I'm not Facebook savvy, but we do have a police department Facebook. And yeah, so anything that's a good idea, we'll have Lindsay take some pictures and get some of that stuff out there. Yeah. See if we can do that. I'm always looking for ideas, and everybody will have, you know, the police department constantly. I don't know, what are we doing on Facebook this week or this month? So yeah, and if you ever have a question, feel free to come to the police department. We'll pull some stuff out and go, this is this, this is this, this is this. And we can show parents some of that stuff. So. We have a display board that we can bring out, and we actually have the actual substances we can that we have for display purposes that we can bring out and show you there. But most of it, honestly, you know, one Google search and hit images, and you will get thousands of books. But we'd be more than happy to talk to anybody that wants to come up to the police department and ask.
Yeah, and sometimes you don't know what you're looking for, so you wouldn't even know.
And that's, I've reached out to the schools to try and be like, hey, you know, like for teachers, like some teachers haven't smelled marijuana. Like, they'll tell me, oh, he smells funny. Like, okay, what do you mean by that? Like, some of them just really don't know what it smells like. So I've offered to say, hey, let's kind of staff development day or something, you know, if I can go in and say, here's e-cigs, here's meth, here's marijuana, here's wax. Marijuana wax, this new thing, it's looks like a lip balm of anything. They keep it in like a chapstick container, things like that. Has yet to happen, but I will definitely do it.
I'm not trying to add to your plate. I was just kidding.
No, I want to do that. Like, I want to. Like,
I would encourage parents to come to the police department and not just Lindsay out of the school. Between myself, the other investigator, one of the other officers. We'll figure it
out. Okay, wait, back to that wax thing. Like, they
keep it in like a Carmex. Like, that's what they keep it in a lot of times, and literally it looks like it's like almost like a greeny tan wax.
It's called wax because it looks just like wax.
And then wait, I'm missing something here. Like, they put it on their lips.
they smoke it, and I don't know how it's made, but it's a very just super concentrated form. And it's a felony to possess this because it's an altered form of a substance. But they dab. They call it dab. They're dabbing. Oh. But they get it on a little. You just smoke a little piece of it at a time. And it still smells like marijuana. You will still smell the strong scent of marijuana, or it'd be like sticky residue, things like that. That's not very popular. I've only handled maybe a handful of cases over the last couple of years. But it's out there, and kids do use it. Like, a lot of parents don't know about wax.
Yeah, we do. Thanks.
Yep. Not your candles. Not your Yankee candle. Yeah.
You know, I don't get many public opportunities to appreciate the work you guys do, so thank you so much, because you work with us very closely. I just wanted to mention what some of the questions that came up. I don't know a lot about this, but the high school has an event on March 14th. Being produced by the Hazleton Betty Ford Foundation and Youth Services Bureau to go over that exact thing, what to look for, what are the signs, what are the posters, what are the substances, so that parents can be a little bit more aware of what they might see in their kid's bedroom, and what is a USB drive versus what isn't.
Is that where they set up the display? They do that part? Are they doing that whole thing?
You know, I think they are. There's a picture on our website that kind of has a display set up to point those things out. Yeah. And if you go to the Stillwater Schools homepage, it's on the main page in the pictures that scroll across the top.
Good to know, because if I have parents, when I follow up with the parents, I always refer to them to Youth Service Bureau. We have an internal chemical health specialist at school, but that's a good one to tell them.
Yeah, so March 14th, 6:30 at the high school. It's free.
I'm going to ask one more for the police department. So you mentioned that the school has its own policy when it comes to an emergency situation. But if it's not necessarily an emergency situation, but there is something that happens that may be deemed unlawful, like a traffic violation or drugs or alcohol or something of that sort, does a call that comes from on the high school campus have a different procedure and or consequences versus if that same act happened off campus?
If you're speaking, I'm assuming with a juvenile still.
Yes, with a minor.
Yep, Yep. So obviously there's going to be a school disciplinary action to follow along with the law enforcement side because we work together. And there are certain violations within state or within state statute that we are required to notify the school about. So if there's these certain dozen offenses that we fill out the juvenile's name, parents' info, school info, what the offense was, and a brief description of the incident, and that is sent to whichever school they go to. And then the school gets it, and then they follow up on their end, whether it's a referral to Youth Service Bureau, they can do their own, like we have a chemical health specialist, and they go through those two as well. So, yes.
Okay.
If it's specifically an incident in the school, we do have several avenues that we can take, whether it's strictly a criminal prosecution, and sometimes that's what happens. The school district is hands off with it and says we will let the criminal prosecution take place. We can do the school also has a connection with the Youth Service Bureau, and unfortunately Youth Service Bureau wasn't able to be here tonight, but they have multiple programs of dealing with youth and different things, whether it's smoking. So a lot, almost all of the smoking violations go through the Youth Service Bureau. We document them and they're monitored that way. And if it's an individual that we've had multiple times, then maybe it would step up, but through the criminal process. But so there's that process. And sometimes, if it's not, I mean, we look at things, what's in the best interest of justice? Is it going to do multiple, whether if the school's taking independent action against a student, whether it be a suspension or a disciplinary action within the school, is it beneficial for law enforcement to throw another hammer down? So sometimes we will defer in general, saying school consequences have been taken, the parents were cooperative and involved in the process, and we refer as in the best interest of justice that we don't do the prosecution. Not to say that we can't go back if the student doesn't comply or some of those issues, but that's basically three avenues that we can take.
Okay.
Yeah, so we work hand in hand, so.
I'm just trying to see if there's actually like a hierarchy here. Like, does the school district override the police department at a certain point, or can the police department override them, or is it parallel? Like, is there?
We don't get ourselves involved in the school district discipline at all. We don't make a recommendation to say, well, you better suspend this person. That is their individual, and it is our individual decision on the criminal justice set.
Okay. So if it's an illegal act, you're going to make your your decision, your action.
Yep. Okay. And they do their own as well.
Okay.
Yep.
Any more questions?
I know it's a hot button topic and it's being talked about, especially in regards to the Florida situation, about all the red flags that were there and some of which were not followed up. And so as far as it's being talked about these, I don't know the term, I don't know if it's gun violence protective orders, these situations where if somebody has enough warning signs, it could warrant some type of investigation by law enforcement, maybe even confiscation of firearms. And that's not law today. But what is law today? So, I mean, if, as far as enforcing what's available or using what's available, if somebody in the school, even somebody who had expressed to a counselor that they could be suicidal or had depression, where a firearm in the home isn't necessarily dangerous to somebody else, but could be dangerous to them, or if somebody has expressed violence towards other students or teachers or something that, you know, is a red flag or a student gets expelled for something like that, what does law enforcement have available to them to protect the students in the school from a student like that having access to a firearm to do damage to themselves or somebody else?
There are some laws on the books already. And the law that you were talking about, that a judge can order that at the time, and they currently do. It's standard practice for domestic assault situations. We take the guns are ordered to turn over to law enforcement, and law enforcement at the scene will, we routinely take those weapons and hold them for safekeeping until the judge can make a decision. And generally, that's what would happen in these type of situations. We do the investigation, talk with whether that ends up being a situation that there is a gun involved or a weapon involved in. We can seize that weapon at that time for safekeeping and or evidence purposes, depending on what the situation is.
And we could be required to get back by judge, or maybe depending on what the situation is. There is no hard and fast, we will take it this time, we will take it that time. But obviously, if we're involved in it, it's reached the level of something other than, you know, just somebody having a firearm in their house, which obviously we can't come in and see. There's a constitution in place for that. So, but if there are other reasons and circumstances and what we would call probable cause, we were able to take those, whether it be for safekeeping or evidence, whatever, to, and then it returns out. And in most cases, we haven't run into this, thankfully, but the parents have been very cooperative in any instance that we've had, and we haven't had that issue, but there would be that situation. We would hope parents would cooperate and say, let's either remove the weapons from the house if there are, if it's, you know, it may be dad's hunting weapons, we don't know. So we hope we would get cooperation in the long run on those type of things.
And those are normal questions we ask is, are there guns at home? Do you have access? You know, do you know how to use a firearm? Yeah, those are basic questions we would ask if it's ever being questioned or being brought up. And like you said, parents are, I completely understand, they're just as concerned as we are if it gets brought up. So
with the heightened awareness about this and with the current laws that we have, I mean, it doesn't sound like you need a new law to be passed necessarily to do what I was asking or what you're describing.
I really don't, in a long-term possession type situation, that may be some legal wrangling, but as an immediate situation, an immediate circumvention to a threat or something, that we would have the ability to deal with that. I think kind of what, and again, this is the political and media and everybody else gets involved in this, and it's kind of like going around the circle of changes stories by the time it gets to the other end. But generally what I saw and what I've heard on this is the concern that we maybe have this individual has felt to be a mental health issue. They haven't done anything, they haven't made any threats, but given the totality of the circumstances, they feel that there could be a. And I think that's kind of where the law was, the general intent of some of that talk was, is what can be done about that individual? And, can law enforcement go in, or can the courts order that they be surrendered, something on that line? And that will that will go to some significant challenges politically, socially, everything else, so constitutionally. But at the time, if we have a threat, we are very capable of, and legally capable, I mean, and to be able to secure those weapons, at least for an immediate cause at the time.
Thank you.
Okay, so the district is big, and so you've got kids who are attending the high school from Afton to Marine, just all over the place. And Jennifer asked about crimes that take place on the school property. But let's say you know that there's somebody who's dealing, but they're dealing out of their house in Bayport. Or you know that there's somebody who's threatening the school, but they live in Marine. What, how do you deal with, you find out, are you then notifying Washington County? Are you, how are you handling that?
We all work in conjunction together. If we have something that we think is going on somewhere else, we'll notify that department, and they may already be well aware of it. But we certainly are getting them in the loop as well. Because obviously, if something's going on in their jurisdiction, just because I hear about it at school, I'm not creating a police report, but I'm going to document it, but they're the ones who are doing the actual internal investigation at that point.
But are you mandated then? Oh, I know that Dee Dee Armstrong is dealing Zanny bars. She lives in Afton. Are you automatically mandated to...
He has a fictitious name.
Well, that's me, and I'm not dealing Xanax bars. Not at all. Very opposed to the Xanax bars. Really bad. But then, as soon as you know that this is going on, are you then contacting Sheriff Starry? How is this happening?
So, like, if a kid comes up to me and says, Dee Dee's doing something, whatever.
She's a bad apple, I hear.
So we have to obviously go investigate, then I should go kick down her door and start doing warrants in the house based on this one thing. I'm going to ask, okay, what do you mean by that? Kind of get more in depth. Usually it's the Snapchat. That's how they're selling. A lot of the kids are selling on Snapchat, things like that. I'm going to depth and see what more they can give me, and then I can pass the information on, and they can take it from there and see if they're, again, the proof of it, and, you know, there's the...
So are you required to pass it along to them, or are you, pass it along to them?
Yeah, ethically, you're passing it
on. Okay, that was, okay. Okay, that's cool.
I don't like that.
It does happen quite a bit.
Oh, it happens a lot.
We have students from multiple cities, and we do it all the time.
It happens.
Information relative to different cities all the time.
Sounds good. And Chief, how many calls do we get a year to the high school?
Well, last count, we're at about 300 and something, so about once a day. And whether you consider that a lot, or, and that encompasses the gamut from the lockout to the, you know, the tobacco violation to assault investigation to whatever we would have that would be considered a law enforcement issue that we would deal with. Not all of them are taking action, obviously. Some of them aren't, some of them aren't. But there again, I guess when you look at the numbers, and that's, I think, and I won't put on the political avenue as to why there is or isn't a school resource officer, but I think that's generally why we see the need for a school resource officer, and I think the school district agrees too. That there's that benefit for both sides of that.
As you know,
because
I already
know. Yeah.
And granted, with the now bigger population, it's gotten busier. So.
Yeah, and I also wanted to say, you know, that the resource officer is so important because, you know, like Joe was just leaving work, or Officer Croft, and he was the liaison officer when I was in high school. I still have that relationship with him. I've known him since I was 14 or 15. I can go up and talk to him, ask him questions easily. And everybody on the Oak Park Heights Police Department is very approachable. As you guys know, I've talked to a lot of you many times.
Not because he's been in trouble.
No, never in trouble, but when I have a question, I know that we can always ask. So.
Like I said, that's what I love. Like, one of the biggest things about being an SRO is, like, after when you see these kids start to mature, you're like, oh my gosh. You know, it's like, I see them after they graduate and they still remember you. I think it's just like, especially like you said, when you'll see them the rest of your life, they're all coming here in Oak Park. And,
So, no, thank you very much, and it's a good position to have. So.
It is fun.
We'll just start the clap. So thank you for attending the first Stillwater Area Informed Residents Community Town Hall, and I hope we have some more coming up in the future. There's a Facebook page called Stillwater Area Informed Residents if you would wish to like that page, and you can find out about more events. And if you are interested in any particular topic, you can message through that page, and maybe we can get an expert on that topic at a community town hall. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.